Audio Renaissance presents The Red Hat Society's Laugh Lines, stories of inspiration and Hattitude, written and read by Sue Ellen Cooper.
5 years ago, I had a happy accident. I gave my friend a copy of a famous poem and a red hat, and by doing so, I inadvertently started a women's movement. 5 years later, the Red Hat Society has over 35,000 chapters and continues to grow at an astonishing pace. I still find all of this very hard to believe. I wrote our first book, The Red Hat Society, Fun and Friendship After 50, in order to share the warmth, camaraderie, and sisterhood that we Red Hatters enjoy, not only with our Red Hat Society sisters, but also with other women, no matter their age, of kindred spirit. Our members were sharing stories with us, stories that were far too good to keep to ourselves, of how the Red Hat Society grew and developed, and the meaningful place it was assuming in their lives. Since the publication of our first book, more wonderful stories from Red Hatters have continued to pour in via email, letters, and phone calls. We are beginning to see ourselves as members of one big family, developing strong bonds of trust and caring. Because of this, we feel free to share our real selves and our real life experiences with our newfound sisters. This kind of sharing is downright good for our spirits and our souls. We are many things to many people, mothers, grandmothers, daughters, and wives. We seek and enjoy new experiences, we travel, we create, we have adventures. So it is natural that we share stories concerning all of these things with others with whom we feel connected. As we love to say, we are not done yet. Since we are not done, the stories keep coming. Thus, this second program. The seasons of life leave their marks on our faces. We like to call them laugh lines, and sometimes cry lines, and we try to be proud of them. After all, we don't want to look like 22-year-old models. Okay, sometimes we do, especially when we're trying on bathing suits. But we're comfortable in our skin, wrinkled though it may be, because life has bestowed upon us the consolation prizes of wisdom and gratitude. Wisdom has come as a result of all that has befallen us. Gratitude is what we feel for the rich relationships and experiences we have had so far, as well as for the additional gift of the time ahead, time in which to continue to grow and learn. And, inevitably, add even more lines to our faces. When a woman joins the Red Hat Society and lowers that red hat onto her head, magic seems to ensue. New friendships are born, old friendships are solidified or rediscovered. But what this new program will demonstrate is that this magic is not limited to the times when we are actually wearing those red hats. In fact, some of the most amazing things happen to us when we leave our hats at home. As much as we may think it's wearing a red hat that emboldens us, that makes the world sit up and take notice of us, we discover that the hat is only a symbol of something deeper. We members of the Red Hat Society are each a part of something important. We belong. We matter. We count among our members a 52-year-old Olympian who will compete in her 6th Olympics in 2006, world travelers who show no signs of slowing down, artists, writers, and other creative, vital women from all walks of life. We are all sisters, and each one of us brings something to the party. We never know when and where we will run into another of these wonderful women, as we continue to find one another in the most unlikely of places. Stories of such experiences and connections will touch your heart and make you proud to belong to our sisterhood, whether you're a Red Hatter officially or just in spirit. The world is a confusing place. On the one hand, there is tremendous suffering, grief, and strife. And on the other, there is still so much joy and beauty in such things as a grandchild's smile or a friend's voice on the phone at just the right time. We owe it to one another to share the good times and the bad. When we do, we learn that we are not alone. We have an entire sisterhood, women who sometimes wear red and purple, to share with. I hope you enjoy these new stories. At the end of the program, I hope you write down some of your own stories, and I hope you will encourage your red-hatted sisters to share theirs as well. Remember your mother teaching you how important it is to share? She was probably talking about possessions then, but surely she knew that sharing in any way is life-enhancing. As we all realize now, mothers know best. Sue Ellen Cooper. The incomparable value of laughter. We members of the Red Hat Society don our red hats and purple dresses at the age of 50. Half a century of living will put lines on any face, hence the laugh lines referred to in the title of this program. Anyone who is adverse to deepening her laugh lines may wish to avoid membership in the Red Hat Society because this is what we are all about. Bonding usually occurs automatically among women who regularly spend time together. What makes the Red Hat Society special is that we go beyond merely spending time together. We devote time to coming up with activities that are guaranteed to be fun. And fun activities inevitably lead to that venerable line inducer, laughter. Imagine you are a set director in the theater. After reading a play to be presented and soaking up its mood, you are charged with creating an appropriate stage environment for it. If a play is serious, perhaps sad or thought-provoking in tone, the backdrop will probably be heavy and dark. All the stage props will be carefully chosen to reflect the theme as well. These choices will subtly set the mood for the audience, even before the first line of dialogue is spoken. All that heaviness will not be lost on them. If the play is a comedy, the colors used to paint the set will be cheerful and lively. The lighting will be bright. The props will be whimsical. From the time the members of the audience file into the theater, they will be primed to set aside their troubles and concerns for a while and prepare to enjoy themselves. When we Red Hat Society chapterettes plan our get-togethers, we are deliberately setting the stage for fun. When each member takes her turn planning a gathering, she has full latitude to dream up an activity that appeals to her, knowing that her circle of pals is going to be game to join her in that adventure. Not only is she encouraged to let her playful child venture out into the sunshine, she is assured of playmates. When you get an invitation to your next chapter event, via phone call, email, or snail mail, it is likely that you will immediately begin to feel anticipation. When you find out that Donna has planned for the group to play miniature golf in full regalia and then go for ice cream sundaes, you will begin to look forward to having a lot of fun with your playmates. A week or a month later, when Karen plans a field trip to that art museum, the one you have never had time to visit, you will begin to look forward to getting to see it at long last. When Susan surprises you with a 6 a.m. phone call and bids you to a come-as-you-are party, you will have to smile, even as you wince. You have had a glimpse of the stage set, and you can begin to make mental preparations to enjoy yourself. You have just received a permission slip for your next playdate. I believe this is the true strength of the Red Hat Society. Together, we are learning to plan adventures deliberately, to encourage one another to find humor wherever it is to be found, and to wring every last morsel of joy out of life. We know that there is nothing better than the sense of freedom and happiness that results from playing together. Playing or hanging out, goofing off, recess, whatever we decide to call it, lifts the weight of years, the burdens of the soul. This playing leads to what is indeed one of life's greatest gifts, laughter. Laughter is good, and good for you, too. All of us know that from personal experience. We have all known the wonderful all-is-well-with-the-world sensation that pervades our inner beings while we enjoy a deep belly laugh. Remember the wonderful movies of the 60s The Pink Panther, Shot in the Dark, featuring Peter Sellers as Inspector Clouseau. I remember being in a theater with several hundred other moviegoers, all of us positively screaming with laughter. In that sort of situation, laughter is contagious. I recall feeling deep gratitude to the filmmakers for giving me such a gift. And there is something about being in the presence of others, even strangers, who are helpless with glee, that prompts us to laugh too. Often it takes only one hearty laugher to spur others to join in. So even laughter among strangers is communicable. It is impossible to laugh without finding yourself momentarily immersed in joy. And when we find something extremely funny, the pleasure is greatly amplified if we can turn to someone we love, share it with them, and watch them laugh too. Their enjoyment is communicated to us, and we get caught up in the fun all over again. In that warm moment of shared experience, we draw closer to one another. I have heard that children laugh around 400 times a day. Adults, in sharp contrast, laugh only 10 to 15 times or so, and even those expressions of humor are apt to be subdued smiles or snickers, not belly laughs. Is this because we adults have lost our ability to be spontaneous, or are we just too sophisticated to allow ourselves to express or even experience unfettered delight easily? Maybe both. Okay, we can all agree that laughter is excellent for our moods. But it is truly amazing to discover the beneficial effects laughter has on our physical beings. If it were possible to bottle laughter and sell it as a medicine, it would be too expensive for any of us to afford. Thank goodness it's free. At the 2004 Red Hat Society's annual convention in Dallas, we were fortunate to be regaled with the antics and advice of a self-proclaimed laughter therapist, Dr. Maxine Harper. Maxine's alter ego, Joanne Sable Augenstein, has since become a valued friend of mine, as well as the queen of mirth and merriment of her own Red Hat Society chapter. Having made an in-depth study of the benefits of laughter on the body, she has shared some of her findings with me. If anybody thinks for one moment that red hatting and the laughter it naturally brings with it has no real value, I invite the doubter to listen to this. Laughter can strengthen your immune system. The value of a strong immune system cannot be overemphasized, as it helps fight off infection, allergic conditions, and, research suggests, even some forms of cancer. When the coin is flipped, we discover that negative emotions, such as anxiety, depression, and suppressed anger, can weaken the immune system, diminishing our ability to fight off infections and other serious illnesses. Laughter has been proven to increase the level of antibodies in our systems and lower the incidence of killer lymphocytes, a type of white blood cell. Researchers have found more antibodies present in the mucus of the nose and respiratory passages of those who have recently enjoyed a good laugh. It seems more than possible that frequent laughter could be a factor in reducing the incidence of colds, sore throats, and bronchial infections. Laughter is a natural painkiller. It can increase the body's level of endorphins, natural pain relievers, possibly preventing pain's onset and definitely reducing the intensity of pain already present in the body. It has been shown to lessen the perceived pain of arthritis, muscle spasms, and even tension headaches. A smile cools down the blood to the hypothalamus gland, who knows how, and a frown heats it up. Can we all agree that it's always better to be cool? The muscles we use in smiling have been shown to send signals to the brain, causing the brain to send beneficial and pleasurable hormones flooding through the body. Apparently, the brain doesn't differentiate between forced smiles and laughs and genuine ones. All that smiling and laughing is accepted literally at face value. So the beneficial hormones get released whether or not the outward expressions of mirth are genuine. I guess the brain says to itself, "We seem to be having a lot of fun here. Better release some of those hormones." Do you remember the Disney movie Pollyanna? Haley Mills played an orphaned child who was sent to live with her sour aunt whose name was Polly. Although the little girl, Pollyanna, had had some hard knocks in her life, she seemed to see only the best in every person and situation she encountered. Her effervescent personality and unquenchable optimism spread joy throughout their small town, eventually winning over even the staid Aunt Polly. The character of Pollyanna was so relentlessly upbeat that her very name has come to be used by cynics to define a person who is blindly, even foolishly optimistic. But if the preceding information is true, it follows that a Pollyanna is going to have a very healthy body and psyche. Cultivating the habit of curving the lips up at the corners and squeezing out a giggle or two at not much of anything can actually be very good for you. Try it. You'll like it. A word about cry lines is in order here as well. There will be no avoiding these. Just like the proverbial death and taxes, they are inevitable, and they will show on our faces, too. Even a Pollyanna will not be able to laugh in the face of serious illness or loss. But when we cry, our friends can help. Though our suffering may cause us to be poor company, true friends will be there to offer what they can, perhaps a soft smile of remembrance or the tight embrace of a loving hug. In cases like these, we know that it is not helpful to try to force humor or make inane comments about looking on the bright side. But patience and empathy are similar in character to humor, and we can offer those. Continuing to cultivate one's capacity for optimism is valuable and adds much to our lives, and by extension to the lives of those around us. If we allow too much anger, worry, and fear into our lives, these negative emotions will render us useless and unappealing to others. I once had a seemingly insignificant experience that had a large impact on my life. I was driving home, fuming over an extremely negative encounter I had just had with a highly disagreeable person, almost looking for someone to take out my anger on. Suddenly, a car shot out of a driveway in front of me, causing me to hit the brakes hard. In a ripple effect, this caused a pile of carefully organized stuff to slide from my back seat into a heap on the floor, escalating my bad mood considerably. The same car veered back into my lane as we both tried to enter the freeway and continued to swerve erratically. Angrily, I sped up and passed the female driver, turning to give her a glower in the process. But when I glimpsed her face, my righteous anger evaporated and shame and pity took its place. She was sobbing uncontrollably, her face contorted in pain. I remembered that the place she had first cut me off was the exit from the hospital. God only knew what kind of experience she might have just come from. As I cast a silent prayer for her heavenward, I also asked for more grace and empathy in my own life. I have learned that staying on the lookout for opportunities to smile and laugh is paramount. This habit makes us healthier and happier people. Healthy and happy people make the world a better place for others as well as for ourselves. As far as I'm concerned, Pollyanna had it right. L.O.L. Laughing out loud at ourselves. We Red Hatters take our silliness seriously. We believe that the deliberate cultivation of a healthy sense of humor can transform many a life situation. And really, there are so many funny things to smile at or laugh about if you stay alert and watch for them. Lighthearted playfulness is our way of amusing ourselves and one another, and my, can it be effective? This spirit is evident in our chapter names, our titles, our outfits, and in every activity we plan. Whether you're a giggler, a chortler, a chuckler, a hand-over-the-mouth titterer, a guffawer, or, God forbid, a snorter, you are warned to avoid consuming liquids while listening to this section. It's only funny when milk comes out of someone else's nose. It has been said, blessed is he who can laugh.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.